Morning, everybody. I want to welcome everybody to April Grand Rounds. I'm Lisa Tatesman. I'm one of the trauma surgeons over at Harborview, and I've been asked to help facilitate this morning's Grand Rounds. I'd like to start with just one of the kudos. There was a very nice patient comment for Dr. Kevin Koo, who mentioned that he was very knowledgeable and exceptionally caring. He was thorough and explained the injuries and made her feel very comfortable and much less anxious. And thanks to Dr. Bore as well for the shared patient. We wanted to start on time because we have a lot to cover this morning. We are lucky to hear from Drs. Robert Dunbar and Ena Nielsen, who are going to give us a bit of a history lesson today, a history of orthopedics from the Stone Age to the digital age. And we're going to start with my partner and colleague, Dr. Dunbar, and then we'll hear from Dr. Nielsen, one of our excellent fourth-year residents. So please educate us. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Tatesman. Yeah, we're going to do this slightly different than usually. I'm going to be the opening act for Dr. Nielsen. So let's just get this. I'm very pleased to be able to do this. I had a lot of fun doing. My dad was a history professor, and I just want to say this is a history, not the history, right? You know, this focus is going to be a little bit more on trauma. I'd be very interested in hearing my colleagues who would be better to talk about their subspecialties of orthopedics, but this is what I've got as a thought for that. So I don't know. My only disclosures are really being a fan of both history and orthopedics, right? Our objectives this morning are really just to get a glimpse into the history of surgery and fracture care and orthopedics, and then maybe gain some insights on the evolution of the principles of that care. So there have really been fractures probably since there have been skeletons. This Allosaurus stubbed his toe 160, give or take 10 or 20 million years ago. And you can see there's callus there, and he was able to heal this despite our not being there. The famous anthropologist, Margaret Mead, was once asked, what's the first sign of civilization? You'd think she might say, pottery shards or improvised fish hooks or, you know, cave paintings. But she said, no, it's a healed femur. Because in the law of the jungle or Hobbes's state of nature of every man against every man, there are no healed femurs, right? Those people are dead. They can't protect or feed themselves. So this means somebody valued that person, cared for them, protected them, fed them until they could rejoin the group. And she said that was the first sign of civilization. So the Stone Age is pretty long, right? It led up until just about 5,000 years ago when we were able to start making, you know, combine copper and tin or arsenic and make bronze. So at that time, we were using just stone weapons and tools, also a little bit of wood, bone, ivory, and horn, although that's not really as well preserved, of course. We use flint for fires, right? So during that time, we were increasingly learning to work together. And that's probably how sapiens beat out Neanderthals, Cro-Magnons, and Denisovians and others. And we gradually created myths. And usually we attributed what we didn't understand to the divine. We did trial and error on herbs and plants. And there was no written language. So this is all oral tradition, passed generation to generation, which is sort of risky, you know, in case somebody dies before they're able to pass that along. They were doing certain procedures like suturing laceration using bone and wood as splinters or needles. They used hemp, animal hair, tendon as sutures. And in certain places, they even used ants as staples. They'd get them to grab onto the skin and then they'd twist their necks off and use them much as we use surgical clips now. They pulled rotten teeth, dealt with abscesses, set or splint certain fractures and dislocations. And there's evidence from France 7,000 years ago, maybe a forearm compartment syndrome or a transchondral that went bad. And this poor kid had an above elbow amputation, but there's signs of callus. So he actually survived the operation. I thought that was pretty impressive till Matt Vincent brought it to my attention that they had done a below knee amputation 31,000 years ago, also with signs of callus, and that the patient had survived. One of the weirdest things from antiquity is this idea of boring holes into the skull, and remains of this have been found on multiple continents. And why? Not exactly sure. For seizures, for migraines, you know, maybe for mental illness to allow evil spirits to escape. But again, callus formation, right? A lot of people survived these, and maybe we're being unfair to them, right? Maybe these were for subdurals. And if you think that's weird, well, they were doing it not that long ago. And if you think that's weird, there's still a trepanation advocacy group on the internet if you're interested. So, you know, 10, 12,000 years ago, we started getting into fixed settlements and bigger ones, you know, as time went on, right? And we started to domesticate agriculture and large animals, right? And as we got greater population, there was a division of labor. And one of those specializations was a healer, often a mercurial or odd person in the group who was felt to have a closer relationship to the gods. And remember, the religion and spirituality went hand in hand with medical treatment. Illnesses and injuries were thought to be punishments from the gods. So a healer had to be able to interpret all sorts of signs and symptoms, the movement of birds, animal entrails, you know, the phase of the moon, and then entreat gods on behalf of their patients with different rites and rituals, spells and sacrifices. On the other hand, there was those who actually did the physical interventions were not priests and were considered lower in class, those who were pulling teeth and dealing with abscesses and the like, right? And that goes on through the medieval barber surgeon to the bone setters of today, who often had little formal education or training, are still present on multiple continents, right? One big advance about 5,500 years ago was the written word, you know, and they started having these pictographs. They were done for commerce and taxes, as you might imagine. And this was an information revolution because it took away that risky oral tradition. You could document stuff. And because, you know, doctors had never really been good at policing themselves in Babylon, they have this 7-foot tall basalt statue of 282 laws. It's one of the greatest artifacts of antiquity, a most complete legal compendium, certainly. It's got a code of behavior for medicine that's one of the earliest guidelines of any profession. There's victim compensation, malpractice. You know, surgeons could lose their hands for a bad outcome. And unfortunately, you know, it's not in Babylon, certainly. It's not even in Iran or Iraq now. It's in the Louvre in Paris, if you want to see it. Not long after that, there was the Edmund Smith Papyrus in Egypt. And this was really the first more scientific than magic treatise. It was a cataloging of 48 cases of different injuries, presented very deadpan as a how-to and what you should take care of and maybe not, talking about reduction and splinting of fractures, that, you know, using of crutches, wound management, meat for to quell bleeding, honey, you know, hyperosmolar to deal with infections, moldy bread for infections as well. So fairly impressive. So 1,000 years after that, in Northeast India near Varanasi, Shishruta was working, and he, you know, was very rational and practical. You know, did flaps for folks who had their noses cut off, for as legal punishment, did styptic cautery. You know, this is an alum salts. My dad had one of these things when he'd cut himself shaving. I don't know if they're still around or not, but they were in use even back then. They used wine and cannabis for anesthesia. And he described hundreds of diagnoses, instruments, procedures, almost like op notes, like right from beginning to end. And he was one of the first to say, surgery is not necessarily a last resort. If we can make things better, we should consider that. And, you know, he was translated into Arabic in the 800s, but he's really unknown in the West until the 1800s, when Hippocrates was already seen as the father of medicine. So Hippocrates, you know, just a couple hundred years after Shishruta, was one of the first to see medicine as science, right? Philosophy. Diseases had natural, not supernatural causes. And he did INDs and reductions and surgeries. He, you know, recognized that diet and exercise affected the human body. And we probably know him best for the Hippocratic Oath. So one of the stories from, you know, the the Greeks, you know, this was seen as a golden age, you know, with the first democracy and the fathers of Western philosophical thought like Socrates and Plato and Aristotle, but they weren't as advanced in other regards, right? You know, women were banned from studying and practicing medicine, right? And throughout most of history, women and minorities were often banned from practicing medicine, at least in many areas. So she disguised herself as a man, and that, but was ultimately found out and brought to trial. And there were massive protests, mostly by women. And her sentence was overturned, and the law was repealed. So that was at least a win for that. Now, these scientist philosophers use their skills of observation to create theories that they tried to explain health and disease and healing. And they came up with this idea of the four humors of blood and phlegm and a couple different types of bile. These all had to be in balance, right? And if they weren't, then, you know, you've got an excess of something. You had to let the evil humors out so that open a vein or put leeches on, which are still in use today. But the bleeding, you know, unfortunately had legs for a couple thousand years. And, you know, George Washington in 1799 woke up with a sore throat and they bled him down 80 ounces, which is 2.3 liters, and he died. Moving from Greece to Rome, as actually Galen did himself, he was a Greek living in Rome, you know, he wrote a lot. He was a surgeon to gladiators and emperors. He did these vivisection spectacles where he would cut the, you know, an artery in like a monkey and ask somebody in the audience if they could stop. And when they couldn't, he would ligate it or do the same thing with it. You know, it'd open their bellies up and have the intestines come out. He wrote a lot, but Roman law forbade human dissection. So he made a lot of errors, but because he had written so much, he had a lot of impact. Now, what the Romans were best known for was their public order, and that allowed for flourishing of other cultural stuff. So here, let me see if these people can say it better than I can.
Yeah, I know, just for us. And from our fathers, and from our fathers' fathers, and from our fathers' fathers' fathers. Yeah, and from our fathers' 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 fathers. Don't leave it a point. And what did they ever give an ounce in return?
The aqueduct.
What? The aqueduct. Oh, yeah, they did give us that. That's true, yeah. And the sanitation. Oh, yeah, the sanitation, Rich. Remember what the city used to be like.
Yeah, all right, I'll
grant you. The aqueduct, the sanitation, the two things the Romans had. And the roads.
Well,
yeah,
obviously
not roads. I mean, the roads go without saying, don't they? But apart from the sanitation, the aqueduct, and the roads.
Irrigation.
Medicine. Yeah. Education. Yeah, all right, fair enough.
And the wine.
Yeah, that's something we've really misread. The Romans left.
Public baths.
And it's safe to walk in the streets at night now, Reg.
Yeah, they certainly know how to keep order. Let's face it, the only ones who could in a place like this.
All right, but apart from the sanitation, the medicine, education, wine, public order, irrigation, roads, the fresh water system, and public health, what have the Romans ever done for us?
Brought peace?
Oh, peace.
Well, there you go. So, well, the Roman Empire lasted nearly 1,000 years, but ultimately fell. And when it fell, there was a loss of this centralized control, public safety, as well as a lack of scientific and cultural advancement. Things fell back into, you know, sort of folk remedies, superstitions, people thinking that diseases and were punishments from the gods. Or from God, maybe. And monks and nuns ran hospitals, but these were mostly hospices and people tried to avoid them. But, you know, even though things had sort of fallen apart in Western Europe, that wasn't true all over the world. This is an early ortho text from the Taoist priest Lin Tao Zhen from the 9th century, said, you know, this could have been in the last, you know, edition of Rockwood, right? For open fractures, the wound needs first to be enlarged with a sharp knife, see the whole zone of injury, right? Then washed out with boiled sterile water. And finally, the fracture reduced, stabilized by an operation. The wound can then be sutured or not, depending on the situation. So there's the whole argument, open versus closed wound management. So fairly advanced, right? And then not just there, but you know, when the Muslims came onto the scene, they took the Greco-Roman and, you know, Indian learning and writings and translated them all into Arabic and then swept across northern Africa and came up into southern Spain, where Abu Qasis or Al-Zahawi was in Cordoba in southern Spain. And then Ibn Sina was a Persian actually working mostly in Baghdad. And they did open surgeries for fractures, and they used plaster splints to support their fixation. And then also put together all this learning that they got from all over the world and what they had added to it as well into a 30-volume text called the Kitab al-Tasrif that was used in Western medical schools until the 18th century. I did a little field work for this talk with my wife just 6 weeks ago. We were at La Mesquita in Cordoba. And you know, this book on the right, Ornament of the World, talks about this culture of tolerance between the Muslims, Jews, and Christians, really a golden age where they really worked well together for a couple hundred years. And then the Crusades and the Muslims came up from North Africa again. And then as that happened and this collapsed, a lot of the Jews and others moved up to Europe to populate the faculties of the newer European medical schools that were coming online in the just after the year 1000. Now, these are medical schools, not surgical schools, right? You know, the surgeons still had their guilds and apprenticeships. So really more medicine than surgery. There were a couple of things that came onto the scene as well. You know, gunpowder had probably been invented a couple hundred years earlier, but as they started getting more and more applications of these, the ballistic injuries are going to be things that surgeons were going to have to deal with more and more. And the distribution of the written word was pretty important. You know, monks could copy about 40 pages a day, and most of their time was spent copying the Bible rather than other books. But in Asia, they came up with wooden and ceramic and finally metal movable type. And then by the time the Gutenberg press came online, they were able to do about 3,600 pages per day. So as the availability of books went up and the cost of them went down, literacy went up. So, you know, things probably weren't that different in the year 1000 than they were in the year 500. And they probably weren't that different in the year 1500 than they were in 1000. But things are a lot different in the year 2000 than they were in 1500. And that's because this rebirth of thought and advancement, you know, Leonardo da Vinci was studying everything, right? And he, you know, his Vitruvian Man, looked at the proportions of the anatomy, and Andreas Vesalius, the Belgian surgeon and anatomist's book on the fabric of the human body, finally corrected a lot of the errors that Galen had done. And Ambroise Paré, who was originally a barber surgeon, became a sort of a regular surgeon in the French army, was one of the first to note that like hot oil and hot poker cauterization probably was doing more damage than anything else, and figured really advanced the concept of ligatures. He did a lot on prosthetic design as well. And the same Ambroise Paré, as well as Percival Pott 200 years later, actually had open tibia fractures from horse riding accidents. And the normal treatment for the day that was a baloney amputation to avoid to sepsis and death. But they decided they didn't want to do that. That was good for their patients, but not for them. So you can imagine them saying, well, we sell this stuff, we don't buy it. And that really stayed a common form of treatment, however, until my maybe forebear, John Dunbar Dunbar, declined that during the American Civil War. Remember, this was the age of exploration. One of the anthropologists working with Cortez and during the conquest of Mexico saw the Aztecs placing sticks in the intermedullary canal for non-unions. And on the right, you can see in the next OR room over, the cardiac surgeons are doing an explant. Once we're getting into the 18th century, you get really the father of scientific surgery. This is John Hunter. He was massively curious. You can see at the bottom all the different things he was interested in. And in order to, there was still a prohibition against dissecting humans. So they had to do grave robbing to get anatomy specimen. And if you haven't been to the Hunterian Museum in London, you should really go. It opens back up. It's been closed for a couple of years, but it opens back up next month. He had this menagerie of animals, and many think that he was actually the inspiration for Dr. Doolittle. Nevertheless, even though Hunter sort of made gentlemen to some extent of surgeons, surgery was still the subject of ridicule and lampoonery, right? It was still more of a risky art than a scientific discipline because there's so many limitations, right? You couldn't control bleeding. There's no concept of sterility, no really anesthesia, imaging, implants, understanding of fracture biology, and really not much education. But a lot of that would change in the 19th century, right? You know, if pain bleeding are a problem, then speed is the hallmark of a good surgeon. This Robert Liston was the fastest knife in the West End. He's another Scotsman working in London and supposedly did a BKs in less than 3 minutes. You probably heard the story of the 300% mortality where his patient died from bleeding. He cut, you know, one of his assistant's fingers, who then died of sepsis. And then one of the people in the audience was so horrified by the whole affair, they had a heart attack. And then the mortality was 300% for that. But, you know, this guy was not a clown. Like he was a good, respected surgeon. There's still a Liston medal given by the Royal College to this day. Not to be outdone by Liston, our own Lisfranc, who was actually more of a gynecologist who was recruited into Napoleon's Grand Armée, came up with a 10-second midfoot amputation, right? And that's not the only thing. I'm going to spare you an image of the other Lisfranc operation, which was a perineal resection of the rectum for cancer using no anesthesia. Speaking of anesthesia, ether and nitrous were discovered in the late 18th century, but by about the mid-19th century, the era of controlled surgery really begins when Morton uses diethyl ether at MGH in Boston. Now it remains to get things cleaned up, right? This Egotz Semmelweis was a Hungarian obstetrician, and he noted that the midwives were causing less puerperal fever than the MDs. The doctors were coming right from, you know, the dissection rooms. They didn't use gloves, and these young mothers were dying of upper GU infections. So he advised washing hands in a chlorinated lime solution. And he got a lot of backlash from these, arrogant MDs who said, well, doctors are gentlemen and gentlemen's hands are clean. Or, you know, should the executioner file his nails on the way to the gallows, which, you know, it's sort of an interesting or ironic analogy if you think about it, right? But he, under the pressure of this backlash, he broke down, was sent to an asylum, and was beaten by the guards, ultimately and ironically died from infected hand wound. Pasteur described the germ theory in the 1850s, cleaning these up, heating things to sterilize them. Lister applied this. Lister is another Scotsman. He came up with this carbolic acid spray. The carbolic acid had been used to clean up the sewers and leaching fields in Glasgow, and it didn't kill the cows. So they figured it was okay to do that. So he'd spray this on the patients all around the room, soak the dressings. It's pretty nasty stuff, right? Phenol is a derivative of coal tar and creosote. So, that was ultimately, they moved away from that, but the principle remained. The autoclave and then rubber gloves and masks started to come online as well. And finally, by the end of the 19th century, Röntgen described, using x-rays, and within a year of this, many hospitals in Germany had these. And within 3 years, U.S. naval ships, in the Spanish-American War, there were x-ray machines on most of the U.S. Navy ships down there. So, I know a lot of you tucked in towards the end of it, but a lot happened in the 20th century. Alban Lambot is a Belgian. He was a pioneer. He actually coined the term osteosynthesis. He's big on preoperative planning. He recognized that articular fractures needed to be fixed and not anatomically. He was one of the early folks to appreciate the importance of the soft tissues. Maybe you've been in the OR with me when I've talked about Lambert's seven steps and how this describes just about any fracture surgery. He did leave out, you know, the preoperative plan. He was an advocate of it, but that wasn't one of his steps, right? And by about, you know, the early 1900s, antibiotics arise. The first one is arsphenamine for syphilis. And that even though penicillin was discovered in 1920, it wasn't really used much until World War II for combat wounds and some other issues as well. So, but problems still remain, right? The results of internal fixation were often worse than non-operative treatment because they were usually accompanied by prolonged immobilization, which is the worst of all possible worlds, right? So when you had these things, patients would get joint stiff, they get fracture disease, muscle atrophy, circular dysfunction. So what do you do, right? You know, the Swiss National Insurance Service complained that if the fractures are healed, why are 70% of the femurs still disabled? And why are a third of the tibias still disabled? So had to come up with another answer. So you got to prevent fracture disease by moving the affected limb. But how do you do that without moving the fracture? So you come back to operative fixation. And this another Belgian, Robert Danis, came up with compression plating using this precursor to dynamic compression, getting rigid fixation and immediate limb mobilization, and getting primary bone healing with osteoclast cutting cones, right? This is around the same time in the 30s that Kuncher in Kiel in northern Germany was experimenting with intramedullary fixation. He was then stationed in Finland, World War II, and the US and other POWs returned to the US with healed limbs. And, you know, his successes might've kept him from facing a Nuremberg trial, though, you know, he was later nominated for a Nobel Prize for this. Around 1950, Muller, who was a Swiss surgeon, visited Danis, and he understood Lambert's principles, and he started this system for internal fixation using Danis's principles. And he published his results, 75 patients, no complications, right? And then recruited a few like-minded Swiss and German surgeons to put together this guild for the study of fracture fixation, the AO, or Arbeitsgemeinschaft für Osteosynthesfragen. Apologies for my German. Their original principles were an anatomic reduction, rigid fixation, preserving the blood supply, and doing early active motion. So they did this, you know, they had a research lab looking at fracture biology, biomechanics, and implant testing. They got a precision engineer to develop instruments and implants. They had a focus on education so people would do a good job on this stuff, with lectures, hands-on workshops, small group discussions. And it was constantly evolving, putting out publications that captured the current state of fracture care, which now is mostly online, right? And they published their results, right? Because as Churchill once said, you know, no matter how beautiful the strategy, sometimes you have to look at the results. And this is around the same time that D.K. Clausen, you know, the end of the 60s or 1970 or so, that D.K. Clausen put Ted Hansen in charge of trauma at Harborview. And Dr. Hansen went and visited Kuncher in Germany before he died, and then brought back this technology and was among the first in the country to do intramedullary nailing. And they published their results. And, you know, the Winquist Hansen Clausen paper in 84 had 520 femoral nails. And, you know, femoral nailing has been the standard of care ever since. But didn't work everywhere. The AO implants didn't always imply AO principles. You know, there were problems with infection, non-union, some disillusionment, particularly in the US, right? Because there's too much of an emphasis on mechanical stability at the expense of biology. So there's a better balance was required. So to improve the biology, figured we had to do minimize further devascularization, do fracture fixation that favors healing, right? Doing indirect reduction techniques, decreasing the dissection, the zone of injury, using things like bumps and traction and distractors and the like to maintain that blood supply. And Jeff Matt's book on this at the end of the 80s remains the Bible for this way of thinking. Another thing we thought about is, you know, is an anatomic reduction always required everywhere? Certainly for joint injury, an open approach, direct reduction, and an absolute stability construct makes sense. But maybe hooking that articular block up to the shaft, you can use more minimally invasive techniques, right? Using fluoroscopy and getting length, rotation, alignment, particularly from the mechanical axis of the lower extremity, getting a functional reduction elsewhere, maintaining the blood supply. Also, maybe take a lesson from intramedullary nailing, right? Using relative stability construct that encourage callus, not primary bone healing, secondary bone healing, using bridge plating, which is still stable, less rigid, but still stable, right? And then finally, Stefan Perrin in the lab at the AO lab in Davos found that the osteoporosis under the plates was caused by bone being compressed and necrosed by the plates, not stress protection. So they said, well, why don't we get a smaller and smaller footprint? So they moved from the DC plate to the LCDC plate to these point contact fixers, and then finally to locking plates that didn't even compress the plates of the bone. So maybe maintain, did cause less of that necrosis to the bone. So winding down, Brad Henley used to talk about the oops of orthopedics was the future of orthopedics, the osteoporosis, obesity, periprosthetics, and such. I would say that we are well in the era of oops in orthopedics. And if you think about those, all those limitations that were around in 1800, really sepsis is the thing that remains from those things. We've come up with the osteoporosis, obesity, and prosthetics. And if you want to add one, maybe ballistics, but I think oops sounds better than boops. So we'll stay with oops. So in summary, we have gone from an art based on supernatural forces to an art really based in science. However, the art of caring for our patients remains, and this art of medicine is among the most important contributions to the welfare of mankind. Thank you. Now I'd like to hand this over to Dr. Nielsen.
So thanks, Dr. Dunbar, for that great talk. I have nothing to disclose other than that I was a history major, and so I'm also a huge fan of history. I'm going to switch gears a little bit and talk about the history of limb deformity, with a major focus being limb lengthening. So as Dr. Dunbar mentioned, while the treatment of limb deformities in general goes back thousands of years, like there are writings from 1000 BC in India detailing treatments for like clubfoot, I'm going to begin in the late 1800s, early 1900s, which is kind of considered to be the beginning of the modern era for surgical limb lengthening. And as Dr. Dunbar has already pointed out, we can learn a lot from history. Orthopedics and medicine in general kind of builds upon itself. That's why we write papers and try and disseminate that little bit of knowledge we get as individuals. Because when you work together as a profession, the knowledge base of everyone grows. And that includes working with our predecessors and knowing our history. So in limb deformity surgery, we can kind of see this progression in action. Individuals didn't usually achieve the results they were hoping for within their careers, but then they had, everyone kind of built upon themselves until we went from simple acute distraction with these really rudimentary external fixators to the Elizarov fixator and even past that now. The first round of innovation with limb lengthening lasted from the late 1800s to the 1930s. It's impossible to separate the development of medical innovation from the historical context, as we've kind of pointed out already. And this is a time when tuberculosis was epidemic in Europe, causing chronic osteomyelitis and skeletal deformity. World War I increased the need for post-amputation and deformity care. And then, as Dr. Dunbar mentioned, sanitation and aseptic techniques were improving surgical outcomes at a rapid pace as people started to wash their hands and kind of wear gloves and things like that. So within this context, we find Alessandro Codavia of Italy, who was actually the general surgeon who first described the Whipple procedure, but his hospital was kind of like, we have a ton of orthopedic deformity, we need you to take care of these orthopedic patients. So in 1905, he began experimenting with distraction osteogenesis and described his method for acute femoral lengthening, and it was really acute. He basically performed an osteotomy, put on a spica cast that was attached to a transcalcaneal wire device, split the cast, and then used sudden traction to achieve up to 8 centimeters of lengthening at once, which he held by repairing his plaster cast. Unfortunately, he noted in his writings a delayed reaction, which occurs in the central nervous system, which shows itself in convulsive attacks, which will necessitate the cessation of traction. Basically, his patients were seizing and going into shock because he was lengthening their sciatic nerves by like 8 centimeters at once, which isn't super comfortable. And then his pin bar device was complicated by necrosis around the ankle and heel, which, as we know, is like a huge problem. But he worked extensively with Vittorio Puti, who was his protege, and took over the chief of staff position at Rizzoli Institute in Italy upon Codavia's death in 1915. His work at the Institute was greatly influenced by World War I and the ongoing TB epidemic. Both led to huge influxes of patients with limb amputations, deformities, and limb shortening, and he expanded the hospital to care for these patients, continuing Codavia's work on distraction osteogenesis and researching and improving limb prostheses. He was actually a historian himself who wrote a whole treatise on historic artificial limbs, which you can still find online. But perhaps his greatest contribution to the technique of limb lengthening was the introduction of continuous traction and gradual lengthening. In a description of his method, he advocated for continuous traction to overcome the elastic resistance of the soft parts gradually and without excessive effort, which might be dangerous. And he had actually seen those dangers firsthand in his work with Codavia. He also introduced the rudimentary external fixator, which he called an osteon. It was basically just two pins fixed proximal and distal to the osteotomy with a telescoping tube in between that could be lengthened to facilitate distraction over time. And using the osteon avoided pressure on the skin that had plagued Codavia's transcalcaneal wire, and the limb didn't need to be in a full extension as it did in Codavia's spica cast. So contemporaries of Pudi expanded on his use of the osteon, developing their own external fixators for slow constant distraction. Two of these were August Beer and Leroy Abbott, and they both separately advocated for a 10 to 14 delay between osteotomy and distraction. Abbott delayed his distraction for two reasons. One, he wished to allow the soft tissues time to heal and swelling to decrease so as to avoid complications related to necrosis and compartment syndrome. And two, he recognized that the early callus that formed in this delay period could then be modified through distraction, improving the stability of his regenerate. His contemporary Beer theorized that the delay would allow the body to exploit the healing stimulus of the hematoma that was formed by performing the osteotomy. He had noted robust formation of bone around fractures where the hematoma was left alone and extended this principle to limb lengthening. But unfortunately, both of these people failed to recognize the healing potential of periosteum and the other soft tissues. And so they're both advocating for careful stripping of the bone during the osteotomies, leading to aperiosteocallus formation with really weak regenerate. It wasn't actually until the 1930s that Habmusch and Finkelstein advocated for osteotomy of the tibia without dividing the periosteum, noting that this favored more rapid deposition of callus and bony union. And they also advocated for early weight bearing in a plaster splint that was reinforced with iron walking bars to take some force off the healing bone and further stimulate bone growth. So at the end of the 1930s, we kind of have the bones, of modern limb lengthening principles. Pudi was advocating for gradual distraction, Abbott and Beer promoted delayed distraction, and Habmusch and Finkelstein had discovered the benefits of periosteopreservation. And these are all principles that we still carry on today and kind of the modern principles of limb lengthening surgery. But unfortunately, the majority of the experimental osteotomies, these custom external fixer devices people were designing, and the unique methods of internal fixation they were trialing, like kangaroo tendon and ivory bone screws, ended in complications. So multiple leaders in the field separately reported on these devastating complications, death, shock, infection, and concluded that the risks weren't worth the minimal lengthening that was often achieved. Even Abbott, who was basically the most experienced limb lengthening surgeon of this period, advocated for contralateral limb shortening over limb lengthening due to the numerous complications. So the end of the 1930s kind of brought about a pause in this field of research. It didn't last for a long time, however, because the 1940s and 50s gave rise to multiple international conflicts that sparked renewed interest in trauma and post-trauma orthopedic care. There was improvements in anesthesia that occurred on the battlefield, and it also drew attention to the importance of rehabilitation. In addition, there were multiple polio epidemics between 1948 and 1955, the sequela of which left some patients with significant limb length discrepancies and other orthopedic deformities that needed a new sort of care. In the West, between kind of 1940 to 1970-ish, things generally stayed the same. We jump a little ahead in our timeline here to the late 1970s, where Wagner of Germany was kind of the leader of limb length limb lengthening in the West at that time. So he's pretty notable for advocating for very careful preoperative evaluation and patient selection. He took into account the difficulty of the procedure mentally, you know, prolonged external fixation, the need for frequent follow-up, and the ability to rehab extensively after surgery. These concepts are still very much relevant today. Good patient selection is just as important and usually more important than good surgical technique. And Wagner's technique was still super aggressive. It really hadn't changed much since the 1930s. He advocated for extensive soft tissue resection, circumferential incision of the periosteum at the osteotomy site, acute distraction until the bone was stabilized by the soft tissue tension, because nerves really like that, and rapid lengthening followed by immediate removal of the X-fix, iliac crest grafting, and plating across the gap, which wasn't super successful. His results were plagued by non-union, poor regenerate, and soft tissue-related complications, basically everything they had been dealing with 40 years later. But you might be wondering, Like, why are we even talking about Wagner's technique in 1970? Like, where is Elizarov? Then you start doing all this stuff in the 1950s. Well, as I hope we've kind of made clear, orthopedics doesn't exist in a vacuum. After World War II, political tensions between the Soviet Union and Western Europe and America hampered the exchange of medical knowledge. Elizarov was working in relative obscurity in Kurgan, which is in Southwest Siberia, in the 40s and 50s. This was a highly medically and socially isolated location. His patient population had a very large burden of post-traumatic injuries from the war, tuberculosis, osteomyelitis, and other chronic infections, and he didn't really have a ton of resources to work with. In 1951, he began developing an external fixator system to stabilize osteotomies and non-unions with minimal soft tissue disruption. Early models were based on the shaft bow harnesses for horses favored in the area and fashioned from like used bicycle parts. By the 1960s, he had done his first successful lengthening of a lower extremity by 25 centimeters. And the patients in the region were kind of starting to give him the nickname, the magician from Kurgan, just because he was healing all of these bones that nobody had been able to heal before. But unfortunately, he was still facing widespread skepticism from the medical community of the Soviet Union. But he kind of got his breakthrough there in 1968 when he operated on the injured foot of Valerie Brummel, who was the 1964 Olympic high jump champion, who has what sounds like a Lisfranc injury that multiple people had operated on and was basically facing amputation. So he saved the Olympic high jump champion, and then he also defended his doctoral thesis and finally gained some recognition within the scientific community of the USSR, of the Soviet Union. But he really didn't become known in the West until the 1980s, when he was introduced through the outreach work facilitated by Thor Heyerdahl, this guy on the left, and a group of Italian surgeons. Heyerdahl was a Norwegian anthropologist who decided to unite people from all over the world and also study ancient forms of transportation by having a group of people sail from Morocco to Barbados in a reed boat. Among the crew were both Yuri Sinkevity, who was a Russian pulmonologist who was friends with Elizarov, and Carlo Mauri, who was an Italian alpine hiker, who was friends with a bunch of orthopedic surgeons in Italy. Mauri had had a horrible open tibia fracture that was complicated by septic non-union with a persistent draining sinus. And basically everyone he had seen in Italy told him his only option at this point was an amputation. But on this boat trip, Senkevich encouraged him to go seek out treatment with Elizarov. And so when Elizarov healed his tibia, Mauri convinced the Italian surgeons to learn about Elizarov's method and this fancy apparatus he was using up in Russia. And they flew Elizarov to Italy in 1981, and he trained the Lecco surgeon in his technique, and they subsequently trained other surgeons. Surgeons like Giovanni DeBastiani subsequently wrote extensively about Elizarov's techniques for a Western audience, even adapting the principles to work with different devices, such as his modular modification of the Wagner external fixator. So Elizarov, what was Elizarov doing up in Siberia? His research centered around defining the ideal working parameters of what he called the tension stress effect. In a series of papers, he had investigated the tissue response to gradual stretching in multiple ways, radiographically, microscopically, biochemically. And ultimately, he found that the tension created by gradual distraction stimulated the formation of not only bone, but also skin, blood vessels, peripheral nerves, and muscles along the lines of tension under very specific conditions. In his first paper, he talked about the importance of soft tissue preservation and stability. And we saw Habusch and Finkelstein had been advocating for preservation of periosteum back in the 1930s, but they were still performing relatively extensive soft tissue releases to facilitate distraction. Elizarov, by contrast, found that a very minimal soft tissue dissection was ideal for robust osteogenesis during distraction, very low energy surgery. The other conclusion from that paper was a need for stability. Highly stable fixation facilitated more robust, more organized osteogenesis. The ring fixator that began with basic bicycle parts was key to his technique because it not only facilitated stability, but also allowed for gradual correction of angular and rotational deformities by adjustment of the relationship between hinges, rings, and wires. In his second paper on the tension stress effect, Elizarov focused on the rate and frequency of lengthening. So he saw Putti in 1920 advocating for slow distraction, but Elizarov really honed in on exactly the amount and frequency that you needed. He found that a millimeter per day at a rate of 4 times per day allowed for reliable, well-organized regenerate that consolidated reliably within 3 months. Anything with lower frequency or higher amounts led to a fibrous union, and high frequency or low amounts led to the risk of consolidating too early. And two other principles that were pretty pervasive throughout these papers was callostasis and consolidation. So callostasis, or delayed distraction after osteotomy, allows some fracture callus to develop, which is then distracted, which we saw Abbott theorizing in 1920. And then in terms of consolidation, he basically left the X-fix on until the osteotomy had fully healed and then removed it instead of what we saw Wagner doing, which was taking it off and then plating and kind of disturbing the whole fracture environment or osteotomy environment. So combining the versatility of the fixator with the careful application of these principles allowed for an extremely wide range of uses: congenital deformity, non-unions, acute trauma, bone transport, and even fixing soft tissue conditions that didn't even have bony deformity, because as he showed, the tension stress effect affected the soft tissues as well as the bones. So by the late 1980s, early 1990s, Losar's work had begun to disseminate throughout the global medical community just in time for the rise of computer technology and more advanced material science to facilitate innovative applications of his principles. And while his ring fixator is still widely used, the rise of advanced computing technology has facilitated the development of increasingly complex variations on his original idea. Probably the most commonly referenced computerized hexapod fixator is the Taylor Spatial Frame, which was the first on the market in 1995. But a bunch of variations on this device have been created after their patent kind of expired. They all work in generally the same way. Two rings are connected by oblique struts that are adjustable and moved a little bit each day to change the relationship between the rings and achieve gradual correction of a deformity with or without additional lengthening. And each of these frames comes with associated software that can be used to plan the deformity correction based on given parameters and will provide a daily schedule of adjustments for each strut. These adjustments can be made by the patient at home, facilitating ease of care in theory, as long as patient selection is careful. And then moving even further away from Lizarov's original fixator is the intramedullary device. So the very earliest lengthenings over intramedullary devices were in the 1950s by a group at the San Francisco Shriners Hospital for children who had polio or tuberculosis. And this was prior to the spread of Lizarov's principles, of course. So they continued to perform aggressive surgery that hampered their results, but they did find that the rush rod gave great control of the fragments being lengthened with this traction counter-traction device. But the first modern intramedullary devices are attributed to Bliskunov in Russia in 1983, and then Albizia and the intramedullary skeletal kinetic distractor. These devices were effective because they avoided external fixation and facilitated limb lengthening, but each lengthening required that the patient or the surgeon physically rotate the leg and therefore the rod components, which isn't particularly well tolerated and could be pretty inconsistent. So it wasn't until the development of motorized devices, either magnetic or radio transmitter controlled, that intramedullary lengthening really took off. Early versions required patients to be in the hospital to have, or the clinic to have the device activated and lengthened because the machinery that did that was really big and not really transportable, which if you think that they need four times per day lengthening is a pretty large burden of care. But advances have allowed the development of small handheld devices that they can take home and can be easily used by the patient after a short training period, allowing for at-home lengthening. So it makes this method of lengthening much more accessible. And as with most new technologies, as surgeons become more comfortable with the basics of the devices, they started pushing indications. So with nails and ring fixators, we can do a bone transport for acute trauma with significant bone loss. Some people use them for assisting fracture reduction intraoperatively. Very small patients sometimes have the intramedullary devices used as extramedullary devices, and they're actually in the works developing a mechanized plate to kind of replace this off-label indication, but it's not FDA approved. And then because the intramedullary devices, you can't see them, they're easy to use at home, et cetera, some people are starting to do cosmetic lengthenings for short stature, which is a pretty big jump from where Codavia was doing 8 centimeters of distraction and sending his patients into shock. So it was pretty quick. I probably could have done like a lecture series, but hopefully you can see how each like generation of surgeons were able to build and expand on the work of their predecessors, even if the path wasn't always super linear. I think a lot of us see the intramedullary lengthening nails or those hexapod frames and can appreciate how innovative those technologies are for dealing with complex problems. But I don't know, with history, it's really cool to see how that technology was born out of necessity for patients with like tuberculosis or polio, and how they started with these super simple external fixators and then just got more complex with time as we kind of worked, you know, within the context of material science and computer science and necessity. So in summary, history is great. Thank you.
Well, thank you both. Really great talks. Really interesting to go through some of that history. I see a lot of nice comments. I'd would like to open it up for any questions. Feel free to put something in the chat or just unmute yourself and speak up. I guess I could just start with one. There's just so much there, but what were either Dr. Dunbar or Nielsen, maybe a surprise or something super interesting that you learned during your research for this talk?
I was going down all these rabbit holes. I mean, I just love reading about this stuff. And so I like reading the stories about all the people who were doing these different surgeries. Like Alessandro Podavia did the first Whipple surgery, which I thought was crazy because he mostly is known for doing orthopedic work. And I don't know, just reading about the people who are doing these things, I think is my favorite part of history and is why I think learning about it is so fun. It's because you have all these great stories about people who are just, you know, normal. And then we remember them for doing great things, so.
That's great. It's sort of a lost art sometimes these days with the bullet points of learning where you just don't get to flip from one article to the next and then just keep learning more and more. Dr. Dunbar, did you have a thought? You're on mute, Bob.
The most interesting thing I found was that, you know, every time you think somebody was the first to say or do something, somebody else earlier had done it. Like, you know, like there was Pasteur's theory. Well, Fra Castoro had talked about that in like the 1500s. And then Marcus Vero in the first century was talking about microorganism or something, you know, akin to that, that was a precursor to that. And then, you know, the Muslims in the 800s, the Chinese in the 800s, even to some extent, Sushruta and Hippocrates had ways to recognize that open fractures needed to be debrided and cleaned out, you know, so it wasn't like we just figured this out, you know, in the last 30 years.
Great. Any other comments or parts that you'd like to share with us that you thought we didn't have time, but we have another 2 to 3 minutes left? Okay, if there's no other questions, there's a lot of great comments. Thank you both. That was really interesting. And everybody go have a nice day. Thank you.
Thank you.